Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of A Hilltop in Tuscany by Stephanie Grace Whitson, narrated by Alexandra Okama. This book is copyrighted 2006 by Stephanie Grace Whitson. This recording is copyrighted 2006 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Recorded Books Inspirational, an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. In this sequel to A Garden in Paris, Liz and her widowed mother Mary are brought together again, and each must resolve the turmoil in their lives. Perhaps what their hearts long for awaits them both among the fabled hills of Tuscany. And now, A Hilltop in Tuscany.
Chapter 1. January 30th, 2004. Omaha, Nebraska.
You should see her, Jeff. The voice on the phone wavered. You should see what that jerk did to our little sister.
Bruises? Swelling?
Hold on, Danny. Jeffrey Scott interrupted his brother. It's been snowing here. I've got to pull my car off the road before I wreck it.
Glancing in the rearview mirror, he changed lanes and quickly whipped the Tahoe into a convenience store parking lot. Ripping the earpiece out of his ear, he tossed it in the empty passenger seat, grabbed his cell phone, and climbed out of the car.
All right, he said. Tell me again.
He walked to the front of the vehicle and leaned on the hood while he listened.
She's got guts, Danny was saying. Somehow she managed to barricade Gary in the bathroom while she packed for the kids. Got them all downstairs and into the car before he broke out. She said he ran out the front door of the apartment complex just as she was driving off. Got herself to the hospital.
Hospital? Jeff stood up and began to pace back and forth in front of the SUV.
Yeah, the ER doctor didn't want her to drive this far, but you know Sarah. Even a cast on her arm wasn't going to stop her from getting the kids to a safe place. Colorado to California in record time. She pulled into my driveway around midnight last night.
Jeff bellowed.
He broke her arm? Gary Henderson is a dead man. If he ever gets within 100 feet of her again...
Hey, man, Danny interrupted.
Calm down. This is exactly why Sarah didn't want me to call you.
She didn't want you to call?
Jeff forced himself to lower his voice.
Why not?
Because, Danny said, you have enough going on in your life without thinking you have to slay a dragon for your baby sister. And those were Sarah's exact words.
I don't have anything going on in my life that's more important.
Yeah, right. Except planning a huge wedding. And a job. And a fiancé who only recently discovered that her perfect father wasn't perfect. And wasn't even her father.
Danny paused.
Look, man. Sarah's right. You and Liz have enough going on. You don't need more on your plate right now. I wouldn't even be calling except I know you. You'd be even madder a few days from now when you found out I hadn't called right away.
Listen, Danny. Liz is okay. Really, she is. I'm not saying our trip to Paris was a breeze, but in some ways it was the best Christmas we could have had. She got a reality check about St. Samuel Davis and ended up being closer to her mom than she's been in years. In fact, after a rocky start... Christmas was great.
St. Samuel, huh? Do I detect a note of bitterness?
You do, Jeff said. But it's my problem to deal with.
And I will.
He stood up again. But right now, I want you to tell Sarah that she should...
Move in with me, Danny said.
I know. And she's agreed to do that, permanently.
She says she won't press charges against Gary, but...
That's absurd, Jeff insisted.
Let me talk to her. She's got to listen. A divorce isn't enough. She needs a protection order.
She doesn't. Not really, Danny said.
And when did you get your law degree?
It doesn't take a law degree to know Gary's not going to be a problem to his wife and kids. Not for a long time. If ever.
Danny paused.
He's in jail.
Jeff frowned.
I thought you said Sarah was refusing to press charges.
He's not in jail for what he did to her.
For what, then?
Armed robbery? Accessory to murder?
Wow, Jeff said. Wow.
Very articulate, Mr. D.A.
How do you know this?
Jeff's ungloved fingers were beginning to feel numb. While he waited for Danny to answer, he climbed back into the Tahoe and closed the door.
Long story, but I've checked it out and it's the truth.
Danny went on to describe Gary Henderson's bumbling plunge into serious crime.
Helped one of his cronies hold up a gas station. The day after Sarah took off with the kids. And they have the whole thing on videotape. Gary was too stupid to wear a mask. Real tough guy, huh?
I don't get it, Jeff said. I talked to Sarah before Liz and I left for Paris at Christmas time, and she sounded great. Gary had finally landed a job. They were even talking about going to church.
Yeah, Danny muttered. Apparently our little sister has been painting a rosy picture of reality, so her two big brothers wouldn't, as Sarah puts it, do anything stupid.
Danny paused, and Jeff could hear him taking a big breath and blowing it out.
Which was, of course, my first inclination when I opened the door and took a look at the latest. Believe me, bro, I had the same reaction as you. Beat the guy to a pulp now. Talk later.
What do you mean, the latest?
He's hit her before?
She never told me he'd actually hit her.
Did she tell you?
Selective revelation, that's our little sister, Danny said.
Don't feel bad. At least she had a somewhat logical reason for not telling you. Not wanting to upset the wedding plans. Not wanting to upset Liz's already upset world.
He paused.
But there wasn't any reason for her not to tell me. I've got nothing going on but watching paint dry.
Jeff smiled in spite of himself. His brother, the restoration expert, could make a joke in just about any situation. Still, Jeff wasn't ready to calm down.
Let me talk to Sarah, he demanded.
She's not here. Had an appointment with a counselor. She's interviewing a few before she decides, but she realizes the kids might not be as unaware as she was hoping.
The kids? What was going through their little minds?
They were stair-step children, having arrived in a successive rush that transformed their once sprightly mother into a round-faced, plumpish earth mother. Jeff could picture them now, 6-year-old Josh giving his 2 thumbs-up gesture whenever something good happened, 4-year-old Andy mimicking his big brother's every move, and Hillary, the middle one, a 5-year-old blonde who loved to play dress-up and pirouette on her little pixie feet. Thinking about the kids settled it.
Tell Sarah you called me, Jeff said, and tell her Liz is fine. And tell her we're coming out.
Danny protested.
Don't do that, man. It's not necessary.
He paused, then said more forcefully,
We're all grown up now, Jeff. You don't have to mother either one of us. And Sarah's right. You and Liz have enough on your plates right now.
His voice was pleading. She's doing everything right, and she's going to be fine. I'll let you know if that changes. He laughed quietly. You should see what I'm seeing right now. The kids are out back with Diego. They're spoiling him rotten. He's forgotten he's a dog. Again. The image of Sarah's three children surrounding Danny's spotted Great Dane brought a brief smile to Jeff's lips. But that image faded to one of his red-headed sisters sporting a casted arm. He glanced down at his watch. We'll be there around bedtime. Let the kids stay up. We'll get a hotel room. I know your place isn't exactly set up for a family reunion. You probably can't get a flight out this late in the day, and even if you could, a last-minute trip is going to make getting through security a hassle. Why don't you just cool off and wait a few days? Check in a couple of weeks from now when Sarah's feeling better and the kids have had a chance to adjust. I thought you said Sarah was doing fine. She is, but... Danny hesitated. Look, Jeff, don't take this wrong. But you know Sarah and Liz don't exactly... They aren't exactly close. That's all I'm saying. So I'll come alone, Jeff said. But I'm coming. He could sense Danny giving in, reassigning beds in his house, trying to schedule these unexpected events into the Franklin Planner's single life he'd constructed for himself. You probably won't be able to get a flight out on such short notice, he said. I'm engaged to a tycoon, remember? What good is that if I can't make use of the corporate gent once in a while? Look, I'm on my way to meet Liz at the estate right now, and we're going into a weekend. I won't be cramping anyone's style by pulling a few strings. Liz can call her pilot and get things rolling, and I'll be there in a few hours. Jeff paused, waiting for Danny to clear organizational space for what he jokingly called the Davis factor in his brother's life. And then he continued. So I'll fly into Santa Rosa. Don't bother to meet me. I'll rent a car. He revved the Tahoe's engine, nestled his cell phone back into its cradle, and put the earpiece in place. I appreciate what you said about Liz, Danny. Really, I do. But she'll completely understand that I want to see Sarah and the kids, and that I need to come alone. If you think it's going to start a round of false guilt for Sarah, then just don't tell her I'm coming. It'll be a surprise, and after I get there, I'll convince her I came because I wanted to, not because I thought you guys couldn't handle life without me. He added, I'll also assure her that Liz wanted me to be with you guys. Jeff could hear the relief in his brother's voice. Okay, man. Okay, if you're sure. Danny paused, then said, So, we'll see you tonight. If you think it will distract them, you can tell the kids I'm coming. But make them promise to keep the surprise for their mom. Tell them I'm bringing pizza. Valentino's. Cheeseburger. He'd been dead for over 2 years, but Samuel Davis's absence still seemed to spill out of his office door every time Liz walked by. She was supposed to be across the foyer in the library, helping Irene set up for a meeting with the wedding planner. Jeff would be here any minute. But here she was again, standing in Daddy's office doorway, fighting back tears. How she wished it still smelled of Old Spice. How she wished she could turn back time. Engineer a cure for cancer. Bring Daddy back. She stepped through the door. She didn't need to switch on the light to know the interior of this room. Dark paneling, deep wine-colored carpeting, heavy damask drapes, and at the exact center of the wall of windows opposite the door, a massive carved desk. Crossing the room in the dark, Liz paused to lay a hand along the back of one of the two chairs opposite her father's. The gray leather was cool against her palm, and she smiled as she remembered Daddy's explanation when she brought up the obvious. The two sleek and somewhat uncomfortable gray leather chairs just didn't fit the rest of the room's opulent decor.
"Don't go out of your way to make people comfortable," Daddy had said. "At least not at first. You can always have a seating area where your better clients and friends lounge. For the others, well," he had winked at her, "it never hurts to remind them who's the boss."
As Liz moved toward Daddy's cushy leather desk chair, she realized that his advice had served her well. There was a sitting area in her office downtown, just like the one clustered around the fireplace on the opposite wall in this office. And while Liz's office didn't have a fireplace, she had created warmth with a reproduction print of a beautiful garden. Sofas upholstered in butter-soft leather, a perpetually well-stocked bar, a coffee urn, and chocolate truffles. People who were invited to sit in Liz's circle of power knew they were special. She paused at Daddy's chair, inhaling again. No Old Spice. But there was still a faint aroma of old cigar smoke, comforting and sad at the same time. Pulling her father's chair out, Liz sat down in the still dark room. It had remained untouched since the day Daddy died. Even when he was alive, Daddy's desktop never varied. Samuel Frederick Davis preached the gospel of organization, and he walked his talk. In addition to the clean desktop, Sam's office boasted organized files and no mixing of paper clips and rubber bands in the center desk drawer. The end of each workday saw only two things left atop his desk's polished surface: a spotless light gray ink blotter and his favorite Waterman fountain pen, cradled in an Italian marble tray Liz had ordered for Father's Day the year after she joined the company. This evening, as she sat at his desk with her eyes closed, contemplating the planning of the wedding he wouldn't be able to attend, her lonely walk down the aisle, her grief rose up and clutched at her heart stronger than ever before. Maybe, Liz thought, maybe it hurt even more now that she knew the truth. Getting up with a sigh, she crossed the dark office to the heavy damask drapes and drew them aside. As evening light spilled through the leaded windows and onto the wine-red carpet, Liz peered outside at the barren landscape and once again tried to come to terms with the revelations of this past Christmas. It hadn't been all bad, of course. When she thought about it, Liz had to admit that, had she met Jean-Marc David a different way, at a cocktail party, for example, she would have been fascinated by the handsome owner of a famous yacht called the Sea Cloud. She would have been drawn in by his smiling Nordic blue eyes, and grateful for the new interest in life her mother seemed to have when they were together. She would have liked him. She did like him. What she didn't like was the way they'd met. Liz, intending to surprise her mother by following her to Paris, and arriving just in time to see her in Jean-Marc's arms. What she didn't like was the way her personal universe had been shifted off-center by her subsequent realization, and Mother's admission, that Liz hadn't inherited her blue eyes from Daddy. Both her eyes and her propensity to hiccup when she laughed came from Jean-Marc David. What she didn't like was the undeniable fact that her mother still had feelings for Mr. David. And, Liz thought, crossing back to her father's desk and slumping into his chair again, in spite of the fact that she was trying to support her mother's new life in Paris, She really didn't like the idea that Mimi was half a world away, while her daughter tried to keep an impossible number of plates spinning. No, Liz decided. If she were honest, she'd have to say that Christmas in Paris had been... Was there even a word for it? Maybe not. But sitting here in Daddy's chair, she could think of a few titles for the movie version. Christmas in the Twilight Zone. The Worst Christmas Ever. The Christmas from... No, Liz thought. Not that. It hadn't been that bad. But for her, it had been worse than the one right after Daddy died. Maybe, Liz reasoned, that was because Christmas in Paris had birthed a new sense of loss. And new questions about the truth that had always been just beneath the surface of her mother's ever-present sadness. Try as she would, Liz could not get her mind around the idea that Mimi had loved someone else besides Daddy, had pretended that part of her life didn't exist for all of Liz's life, and then decided to go back to it, and perhaps back to Jean-Marc David. Closing her eyes, Liz leaned her head back against Daddy's chair, wondering. She must have dozed off. When the cell phone tucked in her suit pocket vibrated, Liz yelped with surprise, instantly upset with whomever it was. If the wedding planner canceled one more meeting, he was fired. And if Jeff didn't show up... What's the matter? Her mother asked. And don't tell me nothing's the matter, because I can hear the stress in the way you just answered the phone. Liz cleared her throat. Oh, Mimi, I thought you were Jeff or the wedding planner, calling to cancel our meeting tonight. She looked around at the office. I'm just a little overwhelmed, that's all. There's so much to do. Wait. What are you doing calling at this hour? It's 6 p.m. here. It must be the middle of the night in Paris. Just think of it as a well-timed call, Mimi said. I couldn't sleep, so I've been thinking about what needs to be done before your wedding. I wanted you to know that I've hired some help for Cecil. You've... What? Liz leaned forward. I've hired some help. We both know Cecil's getting too old to handle the estate grounds, and the fact that your wedding is going to be in the garden is the perfect excuse to get some help without hurting his feelings. George Kincaid's niece, Allison, is majoring in horticulture at the university. She'll be going out on Monday after class to talk to Cecil about helping with the spring cleanup as soon as the snow melts. George Kincaid. Liz rolled her eyes. Her mother's propensity for hiring friends and the relatives of friends had always irritated her. And Mimi was doing it again. I hear that silence, Mimi said, and I know what you're thinking. Just because I was right about giving George a chance to prove he's permanently sober and can handle designing Daddy's memorial wing at the hospital doesn't mean a thing when it comes to his niece's landscaping skills. I was not thinking that, Liz protested. Of course you were, Mimi insisted. What was the point in disagreeing, Liz thought. They were supposed to be getting along better these days. Taking a deep breath, she said, It's an established estate, not a project garden for a student. I want to walk down a lush green aisle in a garden spilling over with blooming flowers and healthy shade trees. Would you really be thinking of hiring a student if it weren't that you know George Kincaid, and you're trying to handle things from half a world away? Allison isn't just any student, Mimi said. And I'm in Paris, Lizzie, not on the moon. I have a phone and a computer, and I can communicate with florists and gardeners and caterers nearly as well as I could if I were living in Omaha. And certainly as much as I would be allowed to anyway. Liz glowered. What does that mean? Mimi chuckled. Calm down, sweetheart. It's not an attack on your character, but it's the truth. You're a detail person, and you always have doubted my abilities when it comes to the details of social productions. And your wedding is turning into quite a production. Mimi paused. And I don't mind, so don't get mad. A girl only gets married once, and you have the right to have whatever you want. I'm just doing what I can to lighten the load, honey. Allison is proof. By the way, I've talked to her, checked her out. She's at the top of her class, very knowledgeable. And she's worked at Mulholland's every summer since she was in high school. She reports to work there the day after graduation as one of their landscape architects. So what's hiring George's niece going to cost us? Liz asked. The quiet on the phone was loud. When Mimi finally spoke up, she was off the topic of the wedding. Is there something you're not telling me about Navis Enterprises? Are we having financial problems? Because if we are, I can call Lucas Santo, and he'll help me put this left bank apartment back on the market. No, Liz interrupted. Why did Mimi always shift into martyr mode? It's not that at all. Everything's fine. I want you to have the apartment. Enjoy it. I'm just... She sighed. It's hard to keep all the plates spinning right now, that's all. The hospital wing, foundation meetings, wedding plans, and just the everyday stuff of business. Being overwhelmed is pretty normal for a bride to be, Mimi said. And you aren't just any bride to be when it comes to responsibilities. She paused. Aren't there some things you could delegate to your intern? Liz closed her eyes. I haven't met with him yet. Really? She was talking in that tone of voice now, the one she called quiet encouragement, the one Liz always thought of as barely masked disapproval. I predict Ryan will be a great help, Mimi said. Try to get him involved as soon as possible. Oh, yeah, Liz thought. It'll be just great to have one of the Foundation board members' sons shadowing my every move during one of the most stressful times in my life. Ryan Miller. Liz hadn't seen him since he was in junior high. All she knew about him was he was a Creighton University basketball star. The kid probably didn't know a balance sheet from a blueprint. He was probably majoring in cheerleaders. He probably had a business IQ of about 70. I've got another idea for you, Mimi said. Really? Was it her imagination, Liz wondered, or had she just sounded exactly like her own mother? Why don't you move back home to the estate so you can oversee things yourself? What? You heard me. Move home. Didn't you tell me you and Jeff were going to sell your condo before the wedding anyway? Do it now. Her voice gained momentum and enthusiasm as she spoke. Think about it, Lizzie. It's the perfect solution. No more cooking and cleaning, and Irene and Cecil will love it. Irene's been grumbling about her and Cecil rattling around in the empty house. Mimi paused. In fact, she added, you and Jeff might want to give serious thought to the idea of making the place yours. Permanently. Liz had to hand it to her mother. After a lifetime of predictability, the woman was morphing into someone who announced one surprise after another. Mimi's voice gentled. Ask Jeff what he thinks. I personally love the idea of coming to visit my grandchildren in the home where their mother grew up. The place could use the laughter of children. It's little more than a mausoleum at the moment. But, aren't you ever coming back to... I don't think so, Mimi said, anticipating the question. I love it here. I really do. Her voice warmed with enthusiasm as she continued. Make the house yours. Redo Daddy's office for yourself. As Mimi rattled on, Liz looked around at her father's office, her heart pounding. Of course, Mimi didn't know she was sitting at his desk right now. Consider it my wedding gift, she was saying. With one condition. You have to give me granny digs so I can visit. Maybe those rooms at the East End. Have Mona call me. I'll get some ideas, and she can oversee the project while you and Jeff are on your wedding trip. You won't have to do a thing. You mean those tiny rooms where Cecil and Irene used to live before you built the apartment over the garage for them? Liz said. Yes, exactly. Mimi must have taken Liz's comment as acquiescence. She was picking up steam as she talked. Your father would love the idea that you'd taken over his office, sweetheart. And Jeff could have the library. Mr. and Mrs. Offices. I love the sound of that. One on either side of the foyer. Do you think Jeff would go for it? It makes so much sense. But Daddy's... Mary interrupted her. There's no reason to maintain that house as a shrine, Lizzie. Start with the old office. Let Mona help. She'll have some fabulous ideas. Mary's voice gentled. I know this is a lot to think about, honey, but at least think about it. And talk to Jeff. And as far as the wedding goes, do what you want. If you don't like Allison, get someone else. Liz drew in a deep breath. If Allison, whoever, was getting hired by Mulholland's, then she knew her stuff. And if Mimi really wasn't moving back... She looked at the west wall of the office, where a framed watercolor of the Davis estate had hung for the last few years. The idea of living here with Jeff was too good to be true. And if anyone could work decorating magic on a tight schedule, it was Mona Whitcomb. Be happy, Lizzie Bear, Mimi said. The oncology wing is a wonderful thing. It's the perfect way to honor your father's memory. And the way you've taken up the mantle and run the company is something to be proud of. But in the end, it's you and Jeff that really matters. Love him, Lizzie. Fill that empty house with children, and above all, love that man. After they said goodbye, Liz laid her cell phone atop Daddy's desk, leaned her head back, and closed her eyes. Mimi had made perfect sense. Every idea she had was a good one. Except that now Liz had several more things to add to her hopelessly long to-do list. Sell condo. Move home. Redo office. Office for Jeff. New master suite. And, Liz thought with another sigh, convince Jeff that it was the right thing to do. Here you are. Liz looked up to see Jeff's form silhouetted in the office doorway. Is it time? She said, and jumped up without waiting for an answer. I guess I must have been daydreaming. She snatched her cell phone up, slid it back in her suit coat pocket, and headed for the door. "We have to talk," Jeff said, taking her hand and leading her across the foyer and into the library. Irene had already brought in the coffee and, Liz noted with pleasure, made some miniature versions of her cinnamon rolls for the meeting. She reached for the silver coffee pot and began to pour them each a cup. "I don't want any coffee," Jeff said. For the first time, Liz really looked at him. "What is it?" she asked, and set the coffee pot down. "What's happened?" She reached for his hand, and together they sat down on an upholstered bench in front of one of the room's bay windows. "I got a call from Danny on my way out here," Jeff began. "You have to take the jet. You have to go out there," Liz said. "Can you leave now? Tonight?" "I love you, Bitsy." Jeff's voice was warm with emotion. He kissed her, then continued. "You read my mind. I was hoping you'd understand. Even if it does mean I can't help you with..." He nodded toward the library table, where their wedding guest lists and various other notes and charts lay waiting for the arrival of the wedding planner. "Understand? What's to understand?" Liz said. "They need you. You should go." "Don't take offense, sweetheart, but I'm pretty sure I can handle all that." She gestured toward the table even as she reached for her phone. "I can't remember what Dave said his weekend plans were, but if there's a problem with him flying you, we'll get someone else. In the meantime," she stood up, "go pack your bags." Jeff stood beside her while she waited for her pilot to answer. Once arrangements were made, they walked toward the back of the house together. At the door, he paused long enough to ask, "Would you mind? Could you call Valentino's and get some cheeseburger pizzas ordered for whatever time it makes sense for me to pick them up?" Liz frowned. "Sure, but the kids love it, remember?" "Oh, right. Sure. Taken care of." How did he do it? Remember little details like that? She could remember the phone numbers to a dozen different suppliers, but she never remembered personal details about people. It was one of the things she loved about Jeff. He noticed those things. "Thanks, hon." He nodded toward the library. "I'm really sorry about..." "Don't be," Liz said. "Mimi just called a little while ago. She reminded me that I need to simplify things as much as possible. And delegate. And she had some other ideas."
"Really?"
"Which," Liz said, "we will talk about later, after you've had a chance to be Sarah's knight in shining armor." "Again?" "I love you, Bitsy," Jeff said, and smothered her with a last set of kisses. After Jeff was gone, Liz called Valentino's for pizza and Vivace to cancel their reservations for a late dinner. Taking a deep breath, she made her way back to the library, feeling both irritated and relieved that the wedding planner was now half an hour late for their meeting. Once in the foyer, she glanced toward Daddy's office. How lucky she was to have had such a man to raise her, and have Jeff in her life now. Sarah Henderson would be better off without her worthless husband. Liz was glad for her. Glad for those kids, too. And, she realized with a glimmer of guilt, she was also glad that, for once in her life, Sarah had run west to Danny for help, instead of coming east to Jeff. And all Liz Davis had to do was order pizza, and meet with the wedding planner, and manage the company, and the memorial project at the hospital, and the sale of her condo, and the move home, and redo Daddy's office. By herself. Chapter 2 Lucas Santos sat at his kitchen table, oblivious to the beauty before him, as the sun glinted off the church spires of Paris. Reaching for the brown wrapping paper he had earlier torn off a package, he ran his finger over the nearly illegible handwriting and smiled. No wonder it had been delayed. Luca could hardly decipher the address on the package, and it was his address. It was a miracle it had even made it to the right street. The shop owner a few doors up had delivered it a little while ago with apologies. He was sorry for the delay. He'd been gone on holiday. But it was here now. Laying the wrapper aside, Luca ran his hand over the rough surface of the old Bible. It had not been easy to follow what he hoped at the time was an urging from God to hand it over to his best friend a few weeks ago. But the Jean-Marc David who had come to Paris to meet an old flame seemed to have mellowed since, as a young motorcycle racer, he had refused to listen to what he called his friend's religious nonsense. And when he had left Paris with a promise for future visits, Luca gave him the Bible and prayed with so little faith that now, looking down at the note that had accompanied the Bible's return, he felt ashamed. It had taken him a while to decipher Jean-Marc's handwriting, but now Luca didn't even need to look at the note to remember every word. In time, I will tell you firsthand, but for now, I return your cherished Bible to its home. I will purchase my own as soon as I reach Fiesole. Perhaps Celine will think her papa mad. Again. But that is nothing new. You will understand what I mean when I say it is as if the clouds that hovered over and around the ship of my life have lifted, and for the first time I see the horizon. Things are coming clear. It should be, Luca thought with chagrin, the best piece of mail he had ever received. And it would be, if only it weren't for the last line. And now I entrust my dear Mary to my dearest friend, until I can capture something of who it is I am becoming. She was his Mary. Which was, Luca told himself, as it should be. Hadn't they loved one another in their youth? Hadn't they been reunited for this very purpose? It was obvious from Jean-Marc's note that, at least for him, the old feelings had come to life. His Mary. It was probable, Luca told himself, that the only things that had kept Jean-Marc David and Mary Davis apart at Christmas were the unexpected arrival of Mary's daughter in Paris, and the fact that Mary had held herself in check for reasons, Luca could only assume, were spiritual. He knew Mary Davis was serious about her faith. At Christmas, when they were reunited, Jean-Marc had been agnostic at best. But if Jean-Marc's message was true, things had changed. The spiritual barrier between him and Mary was gone. Hunkered over his breakfast table, staring at the note, Luca reminded himself that any good friend would rejoice at such news. Luca's thoughts turned to Mary and Jean-Marc's daughter, Elizabeth. Even while she was forced to come to terms with her new reality, Elizabeth Davis had reached out to her mother, embracing Mary's new life in Paris. She had even enlisted Luca's help to find the perfect apartment, and to surprise her mother not only with a new home in the city of her choice, but also with a wonderful violin so that Mary could pursue another old passion, music. Elizabeth must have been struggling with the news of her own parentage, and yet she handled it in a way Luca admired. There was nothing more to keep Jean-Marc and Mary apart. Any good friend would be happy for them both. And he was. Bowing his head, Luca thanked God for what he had witnessed in his new friend Mary Davis's life over the past few weeks, and for his part in it. He'd been so careful to be nothing but a friend since Jean-Marc's departure, to attend to his yacht, and then to his daughter Céline, and the twin grandsons living in Italy. Luca had forced himself to call Mary less often than he would have liked, to always ask about Jean-Marc, to be polite, guarded, no more than a good host to a new inhabitant of the city he loved. But he had not counted on Mary being so lovely, so gifted, so alive. He had not expected the sound of her laughter to haunt his dreams. A man couldn't be held responsible for his dreams, could he? Even now, as he swept his hands through his gray hair, Luca tried not to dwell on the memories. Mary stepping out of a limousine at the opera on New Year's Eve in a shimmering black gown. Mary closing her eyes, taking up the bow and playing her violin. Mary protesting, but finally agreeing to don the leather racing jacket with the yellow accents. Mary tucked behind him on his Ducati, breathless with the thrill of an early morning ride. Mary. This, Luca thought, had to stop. Grabbing the brown paper addressed by Jean-Marc, he crumpled it in his hands. Standing up, he crossed the small kitchen and put it in the trash. He poured himself another cup of coffee and sat down again, forcing himself to open the Bible and read. He could not concentrate. He began to read aloud, but the words coming into his ears fell back out again. The sound of a door opening in the courtyard below his window brought him back to the moment. He stood up and looked down in time to see his nephew Enzo and Enzo's cousin, Adolfo Valerio, opening the crate surrounding the latest arrival for Luca's Ducati dealership. As the motorcycle came into view, the boys made admiring sounds. When Adolfo glanced up toward his window, Luca shouted a greeting and promised to be right down. He was grateful for the distraction. Anything that would take his mind off Mary Davis was welcome today. It was, Luca thought, as he headed for the stairs, unthinkable. Especially for him. A man his age. A confirmed widower. Except that it had happened. He didn't know when. But at some moment in the recent past, Luca Santo had fallen in love again. Liz stared at the wedding planner in disbelief. "You can't be serious," she said. "I called months ago. We'd already set the date." "You called. You didn't confirm." The wedding planner, Byron Albright, looked up from his calendar. For the first time, Liz realized that his green eyes were obviously contact-enhanced. She cleared her throat. "Well, let's regroup. Since we both agree I called first, it seems to me it's reasonable to expect that you'd be working my wedding and letting your assistant do the other one." The guy actually smirked. "That's not the way we do things," he said. "The policy is the confirmed customers have priority. Always." He tapped his pencil on the calendar. "And it says here that you were to confirm the first week of January." He looked up at her. "But you didn't." He'd used about 3 times as much hair gel as he needed to slick back his hair, which was not in any way an attractive style for his narrow head. Maybe it was a new approach to a comb-over. That was probably it. He was balding prematurely. And that earring. Oh, please. You had to be manly to get away with that. Jean-Marc David could do it. This little weasel looked like a weasel playing dress-up. And now he was scolding her for not making one phone call. Liz wanted to scream at him. I had other things on my mind besides calling you. I was losing my father all over again, to a stranger with his arms around my mother. The first week in January, I was too preoccupied to keep up with my to-do list, you moron. Can't you get that through your thick head? Instead of screaming, she grabbed one of Irene's miniature cinnamon rolls and crammed it in her mouth. She knew she must look like a rebellious child as she stood there, chewing, glaring at the wedding planner. Everyone at the club raved about, and purposely not offering him one. Once the roll was swallowed, Liz poured coffee. The silence in the library was having its effect. Albright shifted his weight from one foot to another. He was looking down at the wedding guest list. Perhaps, Liz hoped, he was noting the names on that list and regretting his policy just a little. The mayor of Omaha, the senator from Nebraska, the owner of the World Herald. His cheeks were coloring a little. Liz took another drink of coffee. Her hand wasn't trembling anymore, but she noticed the wedding planner's was. Well then, she said, I guess that's that. She reached for the coffee tray and picked it up. I've got to get these back to the kitchen. It's getting late, and I try to respect my housekeeper's policy to be finished in the kitchen before 10. She smiled. If you'll follow me, you can let yourself out. Without waiting, she headed for the foyer. But surely we can work something out, Albright stammered. Liz shook her head. I don't think so, she said. She looked over her shoulder. You see, it's my policy never to allow myself to be treated like I'm anyone's second choice. As she stepped into the foyer, she heard footsteps as Albright rushed around collecting his coat, his briefcase, his hat. She hadn't liked that hat, Liz remembered. It was so affected. Jean-Marc might look great in a beret, but this guy absolutely did not. At the sound of the front door opening, Liz turned around. I'll expect a bill for your time, she said. And I'll also expect you to cooperate fully with the new wedding planner when you are contacted about the details we've already arranged. She paused. You do have a policy of cooperation with your peers, I expect. Of course, was the reply, edged with a tinge of feigned hurt at the suggestion of anything else. Fine, then, Liz said. Close the door behind you, if you don't mind. I have a phone call to make. She retreated toward the kitchen. The door didn't close immediately. He was watching. Let him. She was Elizabeth Samantha Davis, and she could make a great exit. Mary. It is barely dawn on Saturday morning when my telephone rings. It is Liz, wondering if she woke me. Whenever my daughter asks stupid questions, something is wrong. Tell me what's wrong. I glance at the clock, realizing that it's about midnight in Omaha. I fired the wedding planner tonight. Jeff wasn't at the meeting, and the guy was so impossible. He just stood there with his planner open, staring at me, and reminding me I didn't confirm like I should have that first week in January, so he's no longer responsible. He was going to have his assistant handle things, because he had another client who confirmed. I'm thinking that isn't quite as unreasonable as Liz seems to think. But I'm also accepting a full measure of motherly guilt. After all, my life was the thing that rocked Liz's world when she should have been confirming her wedding planner. But then I realized what else she said. Why wasn't Jeff there? He's on his way to California. She pauses before adding, for the next chapter in the life and times of Sarah Henderson. I thought Sarah lived in Colorado. Not anymore, Liz says, and she explains. My own emotions run the gamut from disbelief to rage against a man I've never met, but have always disliked because of the grief he has brought his wife and children. When Liz finally concludes the saga, I interject. That man... No, scratch that. That creature should be put in a cell, sewed up inside a sheet, and given some of his own medicine. He's lucky he's in jail in Colorado, and Sarah's brothers are in California, or he'd be getting some of his own medicine, although likely in a back alley. I've never seen Jeff so upset. How long is he going to be gone? Long enough that Sarah won't need a protection order, Liz says. Not Gary. Jeff. Is he going to miss work? I don't think so, Liz says. Pauses. I don't really know. He hasn't called yet. But I don't suppose work really matters at the moment, does it? I mean, he has to be with his sister now. That's the most important thing. Sarah and the kids. I know this tone. She's trying to convince herself. Of course that's important, I agree. But so is his obligation to his employer. And to you. Right. Let's hear the rest of that sentence, please. I try to tease her a little, hoping it will lift her mood. You can't fool your mother, Dizzy Bear. What else is going on I don't know about? Do I imagine it, or is she sniffling a little? This is not the Liz Davis I know. I'm such a selfish brat, she finally blurts out. I know he needed to go. I even helped. I arranged for the jet to fly him out. I ordered pizza for him to pick up for the kids. But you're worried about how this is going to impact the next few weeks in your own life. You need Jeff there. I pause. Did you even get a chance to talk about the move? No, but how can I even think about that? What kind of person worries about redecorating and wedding cake when her future sister-in-law has a broken life? A normal one, I say, trying to be kind. But I also want to be honest. And a sometimes selfish one, who's always been the center of her own world, always been handed whatever she wanted by her doting and powerful father. I scoot to the edge of the bed, as if by sitting up, I can somehow make my words hold more weight with my daughter. You're not a terrible person, Lizzie, but you also aren't used to waiting on someone else before you can make a decision and move forward. You're used to being first. Isn't that pretty much what you said when you fired the wedding planner? I expect self-defense and anger, but Liz only sighs and mutters. Pretty much, she sighs. I know you said I'm not, but I feel like I'm a terrible person. Everyone struggles with doing what's best when it conflicts with what they want, honey. We've all been there, done that. And the fact that you don't really like Sarah very much doesn't help. I do so like her, Liz protests. She's Jeff's sister. And she's very different from you. The two of you don't have much in common. You chose the business world, and she chose a family. If you will recall, you had trouble understanding someone else in your life who made that choice, until very recently. You're different, Liz says quickly. You have talents, gifts, interests. So does Sarah Henderson, I reply just as quickly. But ever since you've known her, she has been financially challenged. She's had a worthless husband dragging her down. You can't hold it against Sarah for not finding time to wander art galleries and develop a private self. I don't hold it against her, Liz says in her most offensive tone. She's a great mother, and I admire that. But she could have bought a clue and a diaphragm. No one has to have 3 kids in 3 years. Oh, Lizzie. I sound like a mother now, scolding a naughty child. I stand up and head for the kitchen. This conversation is going to require some caffeine. Whatever you think of Sarah, you need to rethink your idea of motherhood. It's not something a girl with gumption does on the side while she develops other gifts. It's a full-time job for some of us talented, gifted women. Time out. I don't think it's fair, but I have to honor her request. My daughter and I are very different people. When a conversation escalates, we've agreed that either of us can call a time out. We're using it less and less as we've gotten closer, but this is clearly a conversation that's leading us into waters we are not ready to sail. This isn't about me and motherhood. It's about me and Sarah. Well, that's an easy subject. You have to keep trying. You have to support Jeff as he supports Sarah. In fact, I say, launching another ship of hope onto choppy waters, why don't you go out there? It would be a great show of support, and I bet it would mean a lot to Jeff. Go out there and do what? Liz protests. You know how they all are when they're together. It's like no one else exists. The last thing they need is me horning in. Toss a softball around with the boys, I suggest. Take Hillary to Walmart for some new clothes. Walmart? Did she really just shudder? How did I raise such a snob? Oh, well, another timeout topic for another day. Not everyone outfits their children at Gap, Lizzie. Taking her kids there will only make Sarah feel like you're putting her down. I can hear Liz thinking. She may be a snob, but she loves Jeffrey James Scott, and she knows good advice when she hears it. You're right, she says. I should go. If he's still out there in a few days, I'll do it. She rushes through a list of all the things facing her in the week ahead. She is right. She really can't get away right now. Good girl, I say. I'm proud of you. It's going to be very hard for you, but you are going to have to figure out a way to share Jeff until he's sure his family is taken care of. Maybe it will help to remember that his loyalty to his siblings is one of the very things that will bless you in the future. He's going to be a wonderful father someday. Someday, Liz says quickly, with emphasis on the some, s'il vous plaît. I protest even as I pick up the tea kettle and pour steaming water over the loose tea leaves in the basket suspended over my cup. I'm not pressuring you for grandchildren, I chuckle. Although, if I thought it would do any good, it won't, Liz says abruptly. Time out, I tease, and change the subject. Can you get me Danny's address? I'll send flowers. Unless you already have. When Liz sighs loudly into the phone, I feel compelled to ease her guilt. You've had quite a Friday of your own, sweetheart. I'm functioning on a good night's rest. You're still in the throes of the event, not to mention the wedding planner dilemma. I'll add your name to the card if you like, and make the bouquet outlandishly huge. If I do end up flying out there, I'll take more, Liz promises before asking. But what am I going to do about finding a new wedding planner? An idea pops into my mind. The inline skaters, just outside Notre Dame Cathedral, now know me as the Moto Maman. All of that began after the second time they saw me perched behind Luca on what my future son-in-law calls Luca's screaming yellow Ducati. First, of course, the boys noticed the ride. They were practically drooling the first night Luca parked it across the street from the cathedral. When I climbed off and removed my helmet, the incongruity of the gray-haired woman and the racing bike resulted in nudges and whispers, then smiles. The fact I was wearing leathers, outlandish racing leathers with yellow lightning bolts shooting from the shoulders across my back toward the waist, only emphasized the anomaly. I had laughed the first time Lucas suggested I wear them, but then Lucas's nephew Enzo dared me to try them on, and somehow I learned to feel at home in them. In those leathers, on that motorcycle, hidden inside a full-face black helmet with a reflective visor, part of me feels newly free. It is probably egotistical, but I will admit that I enjoy the look of surprise on strangers' faces when I remove the helmet and shake out my gray hair. This whole motorcycle thing has made me feel alive in a new way. I am not what people expect. I like that. And I must admit that when I'm with Luca Santo, I'm not always what I expect either, which I also like. So, since I have become Moto Maman, the inline skaters always shout a greeting when Luca and I drive by. Luca finds it amusing. I love it. It is part of the reason that whenever I cross the bridge onto the island where the great cathedral has stood for centuries, my heart sings. But on this Saturday evening in Paris, as I walk down the Boulevard Saint-Michel, rain transforms the intersections and sidewalks into mirrors that reflect the light spilling out of shops and restaurant doors. I usually pause to admire the sugar-based art on display at a confectioner's shop, wondering how it is possible to create such thin sheaths of fine chocolate and then form them into leaves and flower petals. This evening, as I pass by, I barely glance in. I am relieved when, from the opposite end of the open plaza at the cathedral's entry, I realize there are neither skaters in the street nor throngs of tourists just outside the doors waiting to get in. Fewer people will mean more silence within the vast space, the soaring arches magnifying the unspoken encouragement to look up toward heaven for help, to give burdens to the one who soars above all creation. I slip into the cathedral and sit toward the back. Closing my eyes, I listen, reminding myself to breathe evenly and to relax into the everlasting arms. I whisper Liz's name. Here I am. Again. When words don't come easily, I take comfort in the sound of shuffling feet, as a few tourists make their way up the side aisle toward the famed rose windows. Surely, some of those feet are attached to people whose lives are far more complex and challenging than mine. Thank God he can handle them all, the devout and the profane, the sincere and the hypocritical. I admit to feeling a bit hypocritical. Have I come to Notre Dame because I need to pray for Liz? Or because Luca Santo wasn't available to advise me? After Liz and I hung up this morning, Luca called and cancelled our luncheon date. Abruptly. I don't know what's wrong, but his voice was different. It was clear he didn't want to talk. I tried not to take it personally, but I was looking forward to asking his advice about whether or not I should go home to help Liz. I'm not trying to make you feel guilty for staying in Paris, Liz had said. Which, of course, succeeded in doing only one thing, making me feel guilty for staying in Paris. I wonder when, exactly, does the magic moment arrive when a parent can dispense with the guilt over all their parenting failures? I've been wrestling with the question itself for only a few hours. I've been wrestling with the guilt for what feels like a lifetime. I thought I was starting this new life in Paris with Lizzie's blessing. She bought my apartment. She bullied Monsieur Rousseau into selling me her a violin I don't deserve so I can study my music again. I thought she approved. But I can hear the stress in her voice every time she calls me, and I don't know what to do. When I think about returning to Omaha, I am overcome with dread. It is the last thing on earth I want to do. I've been telling myself not to let false guilt motivate me. But today I'm wondering if what I've been calling false guilt is really God's voice. I only have to look around me at the various artistic representations of saints and of Christ himself to be reminded that sometimes being devout means doing the things you dread and trusting God to help you through it. I sit in my chair for a long time, my head swimming with questions, my heart calling for Luca, who would have the answers, or at least be able to point me to something in the Bible that would help. Luca would know. When, I wondered, did this happen? When did Luca Santo become such a presence in my life? I leave the cathedral and walk the short distance to the brick wall that borders the Seine. Behind me, I hear a roar and turn just in time to see a flash of yellow as a scooter crosses the bridge just to the north. My heart thumps. Again, I wonder, when did this happen? When did my thoughts of Luca Santo broaden from admiration for his spiritual knowledge to loving the way his almost white hair sweeps back off his weathered forehead? When, I wonder, did I first realize that he resembles some of the more mature male models pictured in Parisian designer ads? This is absurd. You came here to pray about Liz, so get back inside and pray. But I want to call Luca for advice. He doesn't have any children. He won't know what to say. That doesn't matter. His voice is so soothing, and he's wise in his faith. He'd have something helpful to say. Have you forgotten that he canceled lunch? Have you forgotten that it was obvious he didn't want to talk on the phone? Gripping the concrete railing before me, I managed to take myself in hand. I'm supposed to meet Jean-Marc David in Florence in a few weeks, and his daughter Céline, and her two boys. He's taking me sailing. I scold myself, snap out of it. You are not going to fall in love with Luca Santo. It's ridiculous and absurd. At your age? Imagine. Which is, I realize as I watch a bateau mouche make its way up the Seine, exactly the problem. I can imagine. Sundays, Liz reminded herself, were supposed to be restful. She could almost hear Daddy opining about the wisdom of a day of rest. Of course, Sam Davis's version of rest meant breakfast at 6:30 instead of 5:30, church instead of the office, and golf instead of meetings with business associates in the afternoon. More often than not, Daddy's evenings on his day of rest meant dinner out with board members, dinners that everyone present knew were only thinly disguised meetings. As she rolled over in bed and looked at her clock, Liz realized Daddy would not have been pleased with his daughter's version of rest. After the fiasco with the wedding planner on Friday night, she decided there was no reason to drive back to her condo, and had scooted up the back stairs to her old room. Snuggled beneath a down comforter, she'd fallen asleep instantly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.